from the tree, every plant that grows on land, when the waves flow in the sea, it's by His command. Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah. Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah. Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah.
Assalamu alaikum rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to Deceptions with Dr. Haitham Al-Haddad as he continues to offer corrections, to clarify misconceptions, and to refute deceptions leveled against Islam and Muslims. In this series, Dr. Haitham is addressing controversial issues and does not shy away from giving you guys not only the framework of how to respond, but some responses themselves. And some of those controversial issues that he has addressed thus far in this series, Deceptions, are, of course, the compilation and preservation of the Quran. He confirmed that it is preserved. Of course, the multiple marriages of the Prophet, peace be upon him. His marriage to Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her. Inshallah, we'll be discussing more, even more controversial topics, including jihad. We talked about inheritance, the women's inheritance in Islam. Is it fair and just or not? And many, many other interesting topics, inshallah. So stay tuned to Deceptions and get online, www.islam21c.com. And stay tuned because I'm going to introduce our special guest, Dr. Haitham Al-Haddad. Assalamu alaikum, Dr. Haitham.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Dr. Haitham, I'm really excited to be part of this series. I really like the topics that you brought forth. And in this episode, inshallah ta'ala, we have another really controversial topic that you would like to address. I think it's difficult to address this issue of apostasy, perhaps, because it's a really, I mean, it's more than controversial. It's a huge, huge. So perhaps we can define this word apostasy. What word is it being translated from? What does this mean in Islam?
Bismillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah. Maybe if we need to discuss this topic, maybe we need to discuss two things, which is freedom of religion and apostasy.
Okay.
And I'm not quite sure whether we will... we can squeeze it in one episode.
Okay.
Yeah, however, if we can't, then we'll see how it goes. Okay. Now, apostasy. What does apostasy mean? Apostasy means leaving Islam to any other religion. Okay?
Okay.
When we want to discuss this matter, we have to discuss another important matter related to Islam itself. What is Islam? You remember in the framework, again, I'm referring to the framework.
Yes.
We said, don't discuss certain things in Islam in isolation from
the context.
Everything. Yeah, the context and other Islamic aspects.
Okay.
Also, we said that we need to understand the nature of Al-Islam. What is Al-Islam?
Right.
Is Islam is a religion?
Right.
Or is it a way of life based on a religion?
Right.
One big misconception that so many non-Muslims have about Islam is the fact that Islam, or their claim that Islam is a
religion, which does not fit Islam, because this is a set of superstitious beliefs.
Exactly. Yeah. Religion means
a faith.
The relationship between the person and whatever he is believing in,
yes.
God or another
yes.
thing.
Okay.
So politics is not part of religion. Social life is not part of a religion,
sure.
etc. While Islam is not like this at all.
Right.
Islam is a way of life that have been revealed from God.
Right.
And the ibadah is of two types.
Yes.
Ibadah that is listed ibadat, which is the salah, the siyam, etc.
And
the non-listed ibadat. It is considered to be ibadah. Because Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. All of their life should be ibadah. Yeah? I have not created jinn and ins except to worship me. قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ.
Everything.
All of them لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. My salah, my sacrifice, my haya, my life,
everything.
My death is everything for
yes.
Allah.
Yeah.
So, there is nothing called this is for Allah and this is out of the discussion,
right.
out of the religion.
This is a secular concept
exactly.
that's been introduced lately
yes.
to Muslims.
Yes, and unfortunately some Muslims accepted it. And the Christians, until now, they are unable to digest this.
SubhanAllah.
Yeah?
Yes.
And we need to emphasize on this more and more. Yeah?
Yes, okay.
That
sure.
Islam is not a religion. Now, once a person leaves Islam, does he leave a religion or does he leave something more than a religion?
He leaves the state, and I compare this with the treason when a spy spies against the United States of America, they bring him back and they punish him with capitalist punishment because he's a traitor to the state.
Excellent, excellent. This is an example. A treason is still a capital punishment.
Yes. In everywhere.
I don't know, everywhere.
It seems that way.
In many European countries, and in many in America,
all around the world.
Yes,
I believe so.
No, I think there are some European countries who do not consider treason as a capital punishment. I think Holland or something.
Okay.
Anyway, but in it is practiced everywhere. So the question is again: when a person leaves Islam, does he leave the religion? Has he left the religion of Al-Islam, or has he left something else? He has left more than a religion. He has changed his political loyalty,
yes,
social loyalty.
Yes.
He has changed all of his views,
yes,
all of his beliefs. He has changed his lifestyle. Everything has changed.
He turned his back on the Muslim nation.
Okay. Just before getting into that, let us understand what does apostasy mean.
Okay.
Because again, I think there is a problem in the translation, because apostasy means leaving the religion.
Right.
Okay.
Okay.
And here we are not talking about leaving the religion, leaving, changing your way of life. Okay.
Yes. Okay.
The way you get married, your loyalty, political loyalty, your social loyalty, and
everything.
Everything. Okay. Now, changing the political loyalty, what does it mean? It is a treason.
Certainly.
It is a treason. So why is it acceptable to consider a treason as a capital punishment and not to accept apostasy as a capital punishment, or changing Islam to any other religion as a capital punishment?
Because they've drawn this line between religion and this,
yes,
is the problem. This is their problem, right?
That is the whole point. Because they say that, oh, freedom of religion. They are talking about the freedom of religion. And they don't mind if there is a Christian changing to, a Christian cannot change to Judaism, because Judaism, they consider it as an inheritance, or as a race.
Okay, race. Okay.
But for example, a Jew changed to Christianity, or a Christian changed to from one domination to another domination, or
becomes atheist,
or atheist becoming Christian, or whatever.
Yes.
So they say is a freedom of religion.
Right.
And they consider freedom of religion as one of the standards, one of the values. And our question, first of all, why do you consider it as one of the values?
Number one.
Yeah. This is the first point.
Yeah.
Why do you impose your value upon our values?
Yeah. Certainly.
Although we disagree that it is what? It is a change of religion. It is a change of life.
Yes.
But to start with, why do you consider it as it should be the universal standard,
yes,
value,
yes,
that everyone has to subscribe to it.
Yes.
And moreover, you know, just before this episode, we were talking about, you mentioned to me the situation
here in some Muslim countries with Christians becoming...
Yes, becoming Muslim.
Yes, yes. What happens here, Dr. Haitham, in the Middle East, as you know better than I do, many Arab Christians in various countries become Muslim. And in fact, what happens, unfortunately, and we have many cases here in the Middle East, is published in the newspapers, it's well known, it's confirmed, and anybody can find out, the family will kill the person who changed his religion to become Muslim, his wife, and even the children, and this,
yep,
is documented.
Yep.
And this is amazing, because we hear these same people complaining about Islam, and they kill the apostate, and this sort of thing, but in fact, when an Arab Christian becomes Muslim, he puts his life in danger.
No, see, believe me, in Britain it is the same. They don't kill because they are afraid of the law.
Because, yes, that's the only right.
But if they can get along with it, they will do it.
Yeah, sure. And
because they torture them. They kick them out. They humiliate them.
Yes.
They punish them, etc.
Yes.
And in fact, we came across some cases where the daughters who accept Islam, or the sons who accept Islam, they felt that they were threatened, and they felt that they put their life
in danger.
In danger.
Dr. Haitham, yes, if I can interrupt you, I'm sorry. I would like to share this brief story with you. A woman here in the Middle East became Muslim. She went to the school to pick up her children, and the husband stabbed her to death in the school. This is documented in the newspapers here in the Middle East. Recently, about a year ago, another case, a woman became Muslim. Her brother or cousin broke into the home and killed her, the husband, and one of the children. And the other child only escaped through the window. He jumped out of the window.
Yeah.
So this is documented. This is documented.
I hope that the Western people, the non-Muslim Western people, are watching this, because if something like this were to happen, the opposite of this were to happen, you will find it everywhere in the news in the West.
Yes.
And you will find Obama talking about it.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you will find our Prime Minister, David Cameron, talking about it and maybe sending a letter to that Muslim country to bring those people to justice, and the news will talk about it everywhere.
But because
it is the opposite,
they actually hush it down.
Yes.
They make it even quieter. You don't hear about it that much.
Exactly.
Yeah, just the back page of the newspaper. Yeah.
It is like honor killing. When they say, oh, in Islam there is honor killing, and if one incident happened in Iraq or somewhere else which is not approved by Islam, everyone is talking about it, and they don't talk. They hide these things, and they don't talk about them.
Dr. Haitham, if we can continue this controversial topic after the break, inshallah.
Okay.
You guys stay tuned to Deceptions with Dr. Haitham Al-Haddad.
Reading the Quran is a blessing. Understanding its translation is beautiful. But diving in depth and extracting pearls from it is simply amazing. Do they not ponder upon the Quran? Every week, inshallah, we will dig deep and reflect on the verses of the Quran one by one.
Quran in depth. With Sheikh Ibrahim Zaidan, only on Huda TV.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back to Deceptions. Dr. Haitham, we got into this discussion very quickly because it is a very hot and controversial topic, this issue of apostasy. But I forgot to ask you in the beginning of the program, is it confirmed that this is something that we do find in the Islamic way of life?
Bismillah, salatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. Yes, this matter which is killing the apostate, or...
For lack of a better translation.
Yes, okay, for lack of better translation, is confirmed. It is, in fact, in Sahih al-Bukhari, and it is one of the Nawawi 40 hadith, which is accepted and is
widespread
all over the Muslim world.
Yes.
The Prophet ﷺ, hadith Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, the Prophet ﷺ said, لا يحل مال امرئ مسلم إلا بإحدى ثلاث. The first one, التارك لديني المفارق للجماعة. The blood of a Muslim person cannot be shed except by three reasons. The first one, the one who leaves his religion, and the one who leaves the jama'ah of Muslims.
Okay? Number one. In the hadith.
Okay?
Okay.
So it is clear.
Okay.
And also, some people said that it has never been practiced. This is the capital punishment for the apostate.
Is that true?
No, it has been practice it during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah jalla, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent a group of companions to kill a lady that has apostated and started to insult the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
And also the words of Abu Bakr. Or is it a different topic?
No, the words of Abu Bakr is
different topic.
No, in fact, the problem with the words of Abu Bakr is because they apostated in bulks, as groups.
Yes.
So people say that no, that cannot be considered
applied.
To be. Yeah.
Okay. Different story.
That cannot be applied because they became like bugha.
Okay.
And they have power, strength, and they had fought against that Islamic state.
This is a different situation. We're talking about individuals. Then.
Yes,
okay,
we are talking about individuals.
Okay.
There is the very famous case of Mu'adh and Abu Musa, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and it is a very authentic story. Mu'adh came to Abu Musa, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, in Yemen. And when he came to him, there was a person shankled.
Yes.
And he said, what's wrong with this person? He said he was a Jew. A Jew here, we mean by religion, not by race.
Yes, right.
And then he accepted Islam, and then he changed to Judaism.
Right.
Mu'adh said to Abu Musa, radiallahu, may Allah be pleased with them, I will not come down from my horse unless you apply the punishment.
Subhanallah.
And to execute him,
yes.
This is the law of Allah Jalla wa Ala.
Mu'adh said this from his horse.
Say this. So Abu Musa applied the punishment and executed the person. There are many incidents.
So this is confirmed.
Of course, it is confirmed.
Okay.
There are many incidents. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said in the other hadith, "Man baddala dinahu faqtulu." The one who changes his religion, then execute him.
Okay.
So it is confirmed. And no need to apologize for it, and no need to say that we need reinterpretation.
Right.
I read a full study by one of the renowned speakers in the West, regarding this punishment, and he said it is not in the Quran. And subhanAllah, that was amazing. So if it is not in the Quran, what does it mean? That it means that we do not take the Sunnah?
Yes.
And if it is not the Quran, it means that it has a less weight than if it was in the Quran? No. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَلَا إِنِّي أُوتِيتُ الْقُرْآنَ وَمِثْلَهُ مَعَهُ. Allah Jalla wa Ala commanded us, وَأَطِيعُ اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولَ. Obey Allah and obey the Messenger.
Of course.
Ibn Taymiyyah said there are more than 30 places in the Quran where Allah commanded us to obey Him and obey the Messenger. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, indeed, what I made prohibited is like what Allah made prohibited.
Okay.
I was given the Quran and what is, or the like of the Quran, which is the Sunnah.
Yes.
Okay. So, anyway, if it is not in the Quran, it doesn't mean that it is not a rule.
Yes,
it is not a confirmed rule, and we cannot apply.
Okay, Dr. Haitham, I think it's also very strange that some people would believe applying capital punishment to a traitor against the state or a spy, it's okay to execute him. But this apostasy in Islam is a wrong thing. So this is very strange. But going forward, are you asking? Do you believe? Should Muslims believe that this law should be applied in the Western countries? Number one, and should it be applied in Muslim countries? Number two.
Yeah, first of all, once we talk about apostasy or the law of apostasy in Islam, we are talking about the law of apostasy in Islam. Yeah?
Okay, yes.
So it should be, the people should be living under the authority of the Islamic State.
Okay.
We are not talking about applying it in the West.
Okay.
Okay, because there is no Islamic State in the first place to apply these things, and it is not for the individuals to apply such laws, because we have to follow the due process.
Thank you for clarifying that, because some people might believe it's my responsibility to do this. This is vigilante. This is somebody might take it upon themselves to do this. This is, of course, should be applied by the head of state or the judge in the authentic Islamic state.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. This that should be very careful. And also, even the scholars said that even in a Muslim state, it should be not applied by individuals.
Of course.
Otherwise, there will be chaos and there will be no due process.
Yeah, of course.
Okay. And it should be applied, and it should be applied by Muslim countries, because we have to protect the religion.
Yeah, of course.
And most likely, if we have time,
go ahead, Doctor, of course.
See, most likely the one who apostates or changes his religion, in fact, he becomes an enemy of Islam
state.
And Muslims.
Oh, for sure. And we see that these days.
Yes.
Yeah, we see it these days.
And we have to be careful. The illa, the legal reason or the effective cause for killing the apostate is not that he will be against the Muslim state or the Islamic state, or he will be an enemy for Islam and Muslims. No, as many contemporary speakers made it. No.
Right.
It is because he has changed his religion.
Yeah, right.
And, you know, in one discussion with some academics, they told me that this issue of freedom of religion, etc., etc. We spoke about it. I mentioned at the end the spiritual side of it. Let us understand it.
And they were non-Muslims?
There were non-Muslims. Okay. I said to them that Islam is a light in the heart. And no one who receives that light from the Creator, from His Creator, would leave that light to live in dark again.
Yes.
And I told them, you cannot imagine this because you did not taste the light of Allah. That's why the one who prefers darkness over the light of the Creator, he is definitely an evil person.
Yes, a danger to society.
Okay, just before even danger to society, he is definitely an evil person. He does not deserve to live.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
And not only that, this evil person, he will be harmful for others in general, because now he is changing his life in general, and he will try to ascertain the new identity, and he will be evil to others as well.
Yeah, certainly, yeah.
So this person, it will be no cure for this person, certainly, except just to get rid of him in the Islamic State.
Okay, Dr. Haitham, of course, there's no truthhood after falsehood. There's no falsehood after truth, as you said.
Yeah.
But what about the wisdom behind this? Perhaps somebody might say, well, this is very harsh and it's applied very quickly. Shouldn't you give this person time to reconsider what he's done? Why would you execute him immediately? And why wouldn't you give him time to reconsider? Perhaps he was under distress, or he made a mistake, or something like that.
Yeah. First of all, no one said that it should be applied immediately.
Okay.
Now, we are not discussing this. We are not discussing the due process.
Okay.
Okay, we are discussing the law in general. How the law should be applied, this is another discussion.
Okay.
And of course, as you said, that the scholars mentioned that he has to be brought, and they have to discuss the matter with him, and they have to clarify it. He has to be given time, and then after that, if he insisted
to continue
in this way, which means that he really has changed his faith completely,
right,
then the law will be applied.
Go ahead.
I don't know. Do we have some time to mention a quick story?
Go ahead, doctor. Go ahead.
Yeah?
Go ahead.
Okay. It was a story by Al-Ma'mun. Al-Ma'mun, he was a great scholar, and he was one of the Abbasid caliphs.
Yes.
In his meetings with people, he saw a person who was a Muslim, and then he became a Jew. Okay?
Okay.
Then he said to him, he became Christian. He told him, you were Muslim. He said, yes. And he said, why did you change your religion? You need to clarify your position. Because if you have a doubt, we will clarify it for you. If you do not have doubt, then we need to execute you, and once we execute you, after clarifying anything for you, we would execute you based on the due process, based on the rule of law, and it will be a just execution.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, then he discussed the matter
with him. Doctor, in this program, in the framework you mentioned, we have to ask people, why are they asking this question to determine their intention? Because why is this a controversial issue? I don't know of any case in recent history, in the last hundreds of years, where this has been applied. I don't believe this is an issue that is affecting the billions of people on the face of this earth. So why should this be a controversial issue in the first place?
Well, yeah, you are right. You are right. I think they just want to attack Islam.
Right, that's the issue. Right.
They just want to attack Islam, and as I said, they just Google what are the most controversial issues about Islam, and they just mention them. However, we are not saying that Muslim countries these days should not apply it.
We are saying they should apply it.
Yeah, they should apply it, because this is part of
the
Islam.
Sharia. Yes.
Of course, they should follow the due process.
Yes.
This is something else. But, of course, our deen should not be insulted. And once you leave the deen of Allah,
in fact,
you have insulted Allah, you have insulted the Messenger, you have insulted the believers, you have insulted everyone.
Yeah, of course.
So we should protect our religion. Yeah. And in any system, there should be a punishment for those who violate certain things. And the key thing is, Islam for us is the most valuable thing for us.
Of course.
So if we do not punish those who are insulting it,
of course,
then there is no goodness in us.
Yeah, of course, definitely. Dr. Haitham, where would you like to go in the next episode, inshallah? I believe we covered this topic as thoroughly as we could in 30 minutes.
We have another topic, which is jihad in Islam.
This is going to be a big topic, and perhaps I wish we could have more than one episode for this one, inshallah.
Inshallah, we'll try to cover as much as we can.
Okay, inshallah. Thank you so much, Dr. Haitham. You guys at home, stay tuned. You definitely don't want to miss the next episode of Deceptions. Perhaps the most controversial of all the controversial issues facing Islam today is this word, this concept, jihad. People are getting scared just when we say the word. So take care, you guys. Stay tuned to Deceptions. You don't want to go anywhere. Don't miss the next episode, inshallah ta'ala. Until next time, I leave you in the care of Allah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Every time when I'm awake, all things that I see, I know it's hard to believe, but it's from the Almighty. When the leaves fall from the tree, every plant that grows on land, when the waves flow in the sea, it's by His command. Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah. Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah. Subhanallah.